the concept of it was beautiful because it was about very cheap, very experimental online learning as a way to imagine identity and build community with a group of students. And for me, I think it hit the mark entirely. And that was the point at which I started to realize that DS-106 as a class was far more interesting as an ongoing interactive experience rather than a static resource created.
Zugehört. Der Podcast rund um Open Educational Resources.
Diese Folge von Zugehört ist eine englische Folge, so we'll switch to English now and we will have a talk with Jim Groom. And Jim Groom is hard to introduce because there's so much to tell about him. So maybe we'll start with a question. Do you actually like being called the edupunk guy?
Yeah, I don't know. I don't really have too much of a feeling one way or the other. Edupunk was fun, but I like it when people call me the reverend. Because what I am is a cheap wholesale preacher about the possibilities of the open online world.
And what did you do for a living in the last year? So, because we tried to do the 3-minute version first, and sure, then we'll go deeper into the steps behind it.
Well, 3-minute version for 10 years. Well, no. More than 10 years ago, I was a PhD student in American literature. I was a dropout, and I became an instructional technologist at the University of Mary Washington in Fredericksburg, Virginia. And I did educational technology. And at the point where a project I was working on that we may talk about called Domain of One's Own blew up, I started my own hosting company with my co-founder, Tim Owens. And I'm now living in Italy in a villa fortress in Sud Tirol.
That's amazing. I didn't know that like 3 minutes ago.
I'm basically German.
You're not.
No, I'm not. But I live close to it.
You're so much advanced when it comes to, I don't know, German standards of the debate. So just starting things up for everyone that is not familiar with the edupunk debate. It was around, I don't know, 2008 or something?
Correct.
How did it start?
Edupunk started as a kind of as a joke, to be honest. The idea was that we were all using these virtual learning environments, or what we call the learning management systems in America, and they were boring. They were systematized. They were centrally controlled, and they didn't replicate the web in any way. So the Edupunk movement said, look, why are we using these terrible tools when we have this explosion of expression on social media? And open source applications like WordPress, Drupal, Typo3, Joomla, you name it. Why aren't we exploring some of these and building our own infrastructure? And so Edupunk was kind of a rallying call, tongue in cheek, not entirely taking itself too seriously, but it did catch on as a kind of meme or as a kind of idea. People got upset about it. People got excited about it. It flared up and then it died away. But Edupunk was really a kind of momentary expression of discontent with the existing systems for teaching and learning.
We get back to the reclaim your own infrastructure question at the end, or not at the end, maybe at the second half of this podcast. First, I would like to talk to you about the DS-106 project.
Yeah.
And basically, it's not a project anymore. But what was it meant to be in the beginning?
Yeah, that's really good. So for those of you who don't know what DS-106 is, one of the ways to think about it, so if Edupunk, which I just talked about, was an expression of discontent with the existing systems, DS-106 was not, we weren't just going to bitch and moan about it, we were going to actually build an alternative. So DS-106 became an alternative premised upon the individual, meaning a person would go out, get their own domain, get their own applications, have their own suite of tools they use, and all of that work would syndicate back into a central course hub, which was DS-106. So it was an aggregation hub of all the work happening from students and people who were taking the course online. Many people called it a proto-MOOC, an early idea of people managing and building their own stuff, but sharing to a centrally aggregated hub.
And basically, who were those people? And what did they do in the web? What did they try to learn?
There were 500 people in the spring of 2011, 60 of which were students at Mary Washington. And the other 440 were just maniacs from around the web. Every country, Germany, Russia, Spain, Argentina, Canada, Australia, parts of Africa. I mean, you name it, people who just wanted to explore digital storytelling. Some of them just wanted to learn how to make a GIF. Some of them wanted to learn how to use Photoshop techniques. Some of them wanted to learn how to tweet. Some of them wanted to learn how to blog. Some of them just wanted to learn how to express themselves with these digital tools. And they came in and out as they saw fit. It wasn't about a certificate. It was all free, open, and online. They would use Twitter to aggregate their ideas. They would use their own blog. And you would get a broader sense of the community of people who were trying to learn. And it wasn't like you had to be in it for 15 weeks. It wasn't like there was a grade at the end of it for you. It was a community you could share your work with.
And it has grown a lot. It's still alive today.
It is.
And can you give us some numbers and figures? Because I know they're really impressing.
I can't. So, I know that we've had over 65,000 posts, and that's just of blog posts. I can't even begin to imagine how many tweets, hundreds of thousands maybe. But Alan Levine, who was one of the co-architects of the infrastructure, as was Martha Burtis and Tom Woodward, said this about it, and I thought this was really interesting and thoughtful. I don't know if DS-106 is massive, but I do think it's fractal. Meaning that there are moments in which this community builds upon itself in different ways at different times, but it's not about 30,000 people taking a class at the same time. It's more about a series of people sharing and building at certain parts of time, and that having implications on a very individual-based level rather than throwing this idea of mass numbers. We never did any kind of, how would you say, metrics on DS-106. We felt like that was not the point of DS-106. We didn't want to have to be beholden to the logic of massive to make an argument for it.
Was there a master plan? So did you just think, let's start with 600 people and then it will grow like...
No, there was no master plan. And here's why we actually made it open, which is an interesting story. Kerry Morgette, who's a professor at Scottsdale in Arizona, wanted to know how to set up her own domain. She said, why don't you do the course online so people can learn how to set up their own domain and web hosting? I said, you know what? That's a legitimate thing. Anyone who's interested could go along with the students in the class and learn, thinking maybe 30 people would do it. And the fact is, by the end of the semester, 500 people had done it. And that was a freak situation because this was before Sebastian Thrun had run his artificial intelligence MOOC that had 150,000 people, which was just mind-boggling by all estimates. So 500 in 2011, which is the spring of 2011, was mind-boggling. 150,000 is, for me, still incomprehensible.
How can you explain that your project just went exploding? Because probably some years ago there were around the globe 5,000 projects set up and said, we want to do something with the web and bring people together and learn together, but maybe five of them are still alive.
Well, I think what happened with DS-106 particularly was there was a community of people who I'd already been working with for years on Twitter, in the blogosphere, and that core group of people brought other people in. And they actually, the people who came in, wanted a place in the community to share their creative work with. It was just a need they had. And so it fit a need for people. There was no fees. There was no notion of you have to now like be responsible to something. It was very porous. And so I think people who stayed and built the community got something from it. And I think what that was probably a sense of community and creative expression and a space online to go to hang out with people. So what was a course became a community, and that community still goes very strong. Although courses happen throughout the year, the course doesn't define the community. The community helps build and shape the course.
You said that basically when this is happening, the class is taken over by the learners. And isn't that, I thought, the most successful story a teacher can tell?
It is. So the one story that's great is, I believe that, yes. So in answer to your question, definitely. And the one story I'll relate is in the summer of 2011, we had what was called the Summer of Oblivion. Because what we would do is we would theme classes. So sometimes we would do Twilight Zone. Sometimes we'd do the American TV series The Wire or the Western or film noir. So just, you know, basically looking at all these expressions of culture as a theme for DS-106. The first theme we did was called the Summer of Oblivion, which I actually taught the class as a character, meaning I wasn't Jim Groom, I was Dr. Oblivion. I shaved my what little hair I have left off. I had a mustache. I came to the class, which was an online class, as a professor, claiming to be Dr. Oblivion. And I was taking on an alternative identity. And this is actually a reference to a David Cronenberg movie, Videodrome. And the idea is Dr. Oblivion has never appeared in person, but only always mediated by the television. Well, I was playing the role of I've only ever been mediated by the web. So, long story short, third day of class, I'm having identity crisis. I talked to the people I work with, and like you, I work with a group of five people. We were all writing the show, kind of. I said, look, I can't do it anymore. I shaved my head. My wife won't sleep with me. Like, she's like, you're weird. Like, why did you do this Dr. Oblivion thing? My kids are running around the house calling me Dr. Oblivion. Dr. Oblivion, Dr. Oblivion. It was a weird moment. So I was like, guys, I don't have the mental capacity. I'm kind of having an identity crisis. So one of the women I work with, Martha Burtis, who is a genius, was like, well, then that's fine. Dr. Oblivion will go missing. And you'll be Jim Groom, the teaching assistant. So that's what happened. The next day, we announced to the students that, look, Dr. Oblivion has gone missing, and we need you to help find him. That's when DS-106 was overtaken by the students, because Jim Groom, who was supposed to be a TA, who was me, became a tyrant and started expelling students from the class. And students reacted, saying, you don't have control over me. Dr. Oblivion's the real professor. And so they formed a class called DS-107. And they actually revolted. And this is all online. You can find it. And the idea was the students took over the class. They built their own infrastructure. There was a kind of tongue-in-cheek nature to it. But there were really students who were like, where is the story end and the class begin? And this couldn't have happened without the online element of exploration and possibility and thinking about questions of identity. Because at its heart, DS-106 is about expressing yourself digitally and what that means and what are the implications of it, what are the limitations of it, where do you want to kind of push hard on that, where do you want to pull back. And creating a character online like Dr. Oblivion was the extreme logic of that notion of identity. And the students themselves had to engage what that meant. So it was the most fun I've ever had. It was 5 weeks. By the end of it, we were all kind of, you know, we had jumped the shark, so to speak. It kind of made no sense anymore. Like, we were using whiteboards. Like, it was terrible. But the concept of it was beautiful because it was about very cheap, very experimental online learning as a way to imagine identity and build community with a group of students. And for me, I think it hit the mark entirely. And that was the point at which I started to realize that DS-106 as a class was far more interesting as an ongoing interactive experience rather than a static resource created that you pretend that someone else is going to remix. In fact, the infrastructure of good online learning and good learning period is community. And we need to think about architecture and infrastructure that supports and reinforces this notion of community rather than constantly building these objectified, commodified resources that we think are going to connect us. Nine times out of ten, they don't. And if not, they just, if rather than that, they actually alienate us by suggesting that the resource is going to replace that sense of community and connection. And so DS-106 flied in the face of how people thought about open educational resources. It actually completely never had any resources. Every individual was the resource that they brought, and they were the actual infrastructure of the course, their sites, their connections, their identity. And so that was, for me, the kind of golden moment of DS-106 is about an alternative way of thinking about OER.
We can tell the audience that we are basically sitting in Edinburgh right after your keynote.
Yep.
And why did they invite you to speak about OER when your first slide says, I'm not into OER?
Yeah, that's a really good question. And after my talk, they're probably asking themselves that doubly.
No.
Because I do think one of the things, I think Alan Levine put this very well. Alan Levine is a technologist from America. I've worked with him a lot on the DS-106 stuff. He said that open educational resources, as it's imagined now, has dealt with the simple stuff, the building and the distribution of content. And it hasn't even done that entirely well. But that's what it's done. It hasn't even begun to imagine the complicated stuff. Human interactions, socialization, our ability to think about education in a complex way online that's not dictated and defined by resources. So I do think, or I want to believe, that people see DS-106 as a potential, one potential alternative to OERs. Meaning, how do we build an infrastructure and a community that is built around people and sharing and community rather than around resources that are, like I said, static, objectified, and not all that compelling? I mean, how many of you who have been through college out there in the audience remember their textbooks fondly, right? Like, your experience with college was probably defined by the people who informed you, who talked to you about movies, who talked to you about books, who inspired you with science or religion or what have you. These are the things that made up your education. The textbooks might have filled in gaps. They might have helped you pass tests. But nine times out of ten, they were not the thing that helped define who you are in your most formative years. So how we do that online is still a very pressing issue. And I think DS-106 is only one, but one alternative to thinking about that.
Let's talk about tech infrastructure. Yeah. You already mentioned the aggregation of blocks, and we don't see so many examples on this in Germany. So could you explain how that works, not on the technical level, but on the how it's meant to be?
Sure, absolutely. So if we think about DS-106 as a constellation of sites, right? Every student with their own domain and their own blog, whether it's WordPress, what you name it, posting, we need a way to aggregate that information to one central site, ds106.us. So we've used WordPress to actually grab the RSS feed from all the people who sign up for the course and aggregate their work into the site. When you click on the link, though, you're returned to that person's space. So it's a very simple concept, right? It's really simple syndication. It's the idea that every blog is built with an RSS feed that allows you to syndicate content and data into a central hub. Key for me here, though, is how I know we have 65,000 posts is that every post that's posted by that person is also archived on the central hub. So in some ways, it's mimicking the logic of the web. It's a distributed node that also can centrally store and reposit examples of that. So when that student's URL dies or when they go away, we have an example of it. None of that's public, but it is there as an archive of the experience that happened in the class, which I find compelling because not all students keep their domain. Maybe 30% of them do. So I'm not even pretending like this is the solution and every student loves their own domain and they're going to go do it forever. But the fact that one in three choose to, and the other two or 60% that don't know how to, is a powerful notion of literacy and understanding a little bit of how the web works.
Can you describe the idea of the, is it called a project bank?
Yes,
assignment bank. Yes, an assignment bank. How does it work?
Yeah, I will. I'm going to have a sip of coffee first. Sorry, people. Yeah.
Just fine.
I love coffee. Do you love coffee?
Actually, I quit caffeine 1.5 years ago. And the only exceptions I'm making is on conferences.
That's awesome. So does it feel good being bad?
Yes. Actually, it's I'm doing fine without coffee. Not in the morning, but the afternoon is much better. I used to have a real down in the afternoon. So
that's right.
Really, really down. Yeah. And it's gone completely.
Did you have a headache when you quit?
Yes,
you
for
did?
1 week. And I used the time around New Year. Huh? So I had 1 week when I could sleep a lot and doing a lot of, I don't know, fresh air activities.
Sure.
And didn't have too much many people around me. So but after 1 week, everything was okay.
I can't now, living in Italy, even imagine quitting coffee.
Yeah.
It would be almost impossible. But I might. Who knows? You never know.
You never know.
Hope springs eternal. Assignment bank. So the DS-106 assignment bank was built by Martha Burtis, who was a colleague who I talked about earlier with Dr. Oblivion, and she's the one who had the idea to let the course ride. So she had a brilliant idea. Her idea was, we already have all this data syndicating into the hub. If we ask students to tag this data in specific ways, structured ways, we could actually push it out to data to assignment posts. So all of the work they were doing could show up in an assignment bank. So if you did this animated GIF, you know, assignment, for example, it would show up. All the people who did it, you would see their examples. What's more, if you tagged it differently, it could show up there as a tutorial. So other people who wanted to learn how to do it could, based on what you did. Because a lot of what DS-106 was about was narrating your work. Narrating your public persona of how you did something and why. So it wasn't just enough to do something. You had to talk about what your choices were, why you did it, what tools you used, and what was your assessment of it.
Uh-huh.
So you would really go through the whole process. And so this assignment bank aggregated everybody who had done all these different assignments. And so 5 years on, there's, I want to say, 11,000 examples of over 900 assignments. So we have had students generate almost 1,000 assignments, and there are 11,000 examples of people who have done those assignments. So that's a little bit of the scale of just how much work people have done to build out and to create this assignment bank. What I always loved about the assignment bank was it was open to anyone. So we did it at Mary Washington, and students did it there, but as I mentioned today in the keynote, we have primary school students from around the U.S. using various assignments and using them to create it. And they can submit the URL. They can do it on their own blog. They can do it behind a firewall, wherever they want to do it. The assignment bank itself that was open and accessible. And it was managed and imagined based on a knitting site called Ravelry. So Ravelry was a place where people would post images of the knit work they had done, and other people would comment on it and share it, and then they would do versions and share their versions. And I always thought, what a great model. Why couldn't we do that for assignments in a class? And that's really was the inspiration for it. Pretty simple.
Let's come back to the, I don't know, borrowing 95% of higher education or education in general. Why do learners not take over the infrastructure or their learning? So when you experience these great examples, you could think that, okay, there's everything that learners need for manage their own education. You could connect to the people out there. You have the infrastructure. You have the content.
Yeah.
But in 99%, learners do not take over their own learning. Not their classes, not their courses, nothing.
No.
Why not? And maybe second question connected to that, why do we need the institutions in 2016?
Two good questions. I believe oftentimes students don't take over their own learning because there's no opportunity, right? Like, how many times are you in a sense where you're giving your faculty is saying, decide the tools you use, decide where you do it. I'll make sure there's an infrastructure that will bring it all together and manage it. I would say rarely, if ever. For a lot of students, DS-106 was their only example in their higher ed experience where they did that. It didn't happen again for them. So there's that. But I also think it's messy. Like, that's the thing. It's like, it's not clean. It's not easy. It demands a certain amount of tolerance for chaos. And it demands a certain amount of ability on the faculty and the students alike to let go. Let go of power, let go of control, and let things unfold. And the idea that education is messy, the idea that it is open-ended, it is ambiguous, it has its not always very clear between, you know, a clear right, a clear wrong, right? There's that gray in between. I think this mimics that in a lot of ways. And I think the web infrastructure mimics that, right? It's not a centralized, systematized, it's a whole series of distributed, decentralized networks. Well, what happens when you build a class around that logic? Well, it's going to be messy. It's going to be disjointed. But I do think it's also going to force the students to navigate and negotiate and think critically about that space rather than it being so cut and dried. So, I mean, it's not for everybody. You know, it would, certain people would completely fail within that infrastructure, I think. Certain people would really thrive. And so, you know, that's why I don't offer up DS-106 as a panacea. I don't think it's a solution to educational technology's problems. I don't think it's a solution to how we all are going to learn in the future. I do think it points to the power of enabling students to manage their own infrastructure. But what we are missing is the ability to make that easier and more streamlined. But I do think that's coming.
Okay, so maybe we can take a look at the evolution. So if there's no evolution in educational institutions, I assume there will be no in the next years.
Yeah.
What could institutions adapt from the huge ideas of your work, basically? So could for I don't know, I wrote a concept in Germany for a so-called Abi-MOOC. So Abi is the graduation after high school. So because basically that's a great opportunity for a community to get together, because we have like in Germany 300 something thousand students preparing for the same topics at the same time. So why not connect them? But yeah, of course, these are topics that they have not chosen by themselves. So that's probably key.
Yeah.
But what could we adapt from the great ideas to the dirty world of education out there?
Well, that's a really good question. I'm of one that I hope institutions don't go away. Like, I am not sitting here at the gates of the institution saying, go away, rah, rah, rah. I think they offer a lot of very interesting, powerful infrastructure for what we do. And I do think that one of the ways institutions could really help and help themselves, help their students, help their faculty is not think so systemically about technology, meaning not try and build these enterprise systems that support one thing or two things. I think what would be even more interesting is them to think about, look, infrastructure's changing, architecture's changing, you know, we watch what's happening with the virtualization of servers. I've talked a little bit about containers and Docker and how the shipping metaphor about how servers and virtualization will change effectively how we think about infrastructure. It will allow it to scale it more seamlessly. It will allow it to be safer, more personalized. How can infrastructure at a university in Germany or at a university in Italy or a university in America think about giving faculty, students, and staff more control and power over their data, which is a big issue, we know, after the Snowden, you know, NSA leaks, our personal data is at risk. How do we ensure that we control more of it? How, when a university tries to get our data, do we, you know, set up a negotiation that's somewhat intelligent? Like, Say a university in Germany, I'm applying and they want my information, right? Where can I control what information they get or know when they're using it or know at a certain point that that information is no longer accessible to them? So the idea there is, why don't we build systems that enable and empower individuals to manage their own data and share intelligently? This is happening right now with APIs. Applications are doing it all the time. Why can't we give individuals a personal API that enables them to share back and forth data and also build on that an infrastructure that gives the individual the ability to use all sorts of tools and applications? And through APIs, translate that to a particular tool that the school does support. So there's no reason why I can't write a blog post in WordPress for a class, click send to class, and that automatically translates into a Canvas or a Blackboard or whatever LMS or VLE system you use. We have the connections and the ability to make these translations now. So I think thinking architecture more along the lines of a hub system where the individual endpoint shares and sends into, but is not controlled and dictated and commandeered by your choices as a technology infrastructure. So in fact, we become a lot more tool agnostic and we build a common infrastructure like the internet that enables us to connect and translate between nodes rather than kind of monolithically deciding the system everyone will use. Does that make any sense? I'm not sure it does.
Yes, it surely does. And it's interesting because it might be an answer for the German debate, because Germany, before we would even start trying something new, we would discuss for years about, can you have students on Twitter or other evil capitalists in places on the web? And it's very much about privacy issues and safety issues and everything.
Sure.
So probably in 15 out of 16 states in Germany, it is forbidden for teachers in K-12 to let their students use Google Docs, for example.
Yeah.
And they're not allowed to communicate via Facebook or WhatsApp or everything. So the question would always be, how can you let the poor students get into the arms of the evil corporations? But that might be an answer. But you should give the answer. I already learned it from your keynote.
Well, I don't disagree with Germany's, you know, minding that information for students. I do think it's smart. I think security is, and personal, and the management of personal data is extremely important. And I think that's a great example of where institutions and states can take a leading role in protecting their citizens. I think to back that protection up, we need to think about building networks which allow students and faculty to manage that. And so that means on an educational level, we give students or faculty or staff the ability to define and decide what data they share, when, for how long, and with whom. And that's called the personal API, right? The university, on its part, should have what we would call a university API. And the university, Brigham Young University, is experimenting with this concept with us right now. And the idea is those university APIs talk to an individual API. So here I am on my own domain, jimgroom.com, writing a blog post. And underneath my blog post, I have a couple of buttons. One of them is, say, Canvas or Blackboard. I write my post, send it to my blog, and send it to the course site. That API is connecting with the university and saying, look, he is allowing this post to be publicly posted on this site or not publicly posted. It's actually a far more granular and empowering infrastructure for defining where things go. We've been doing that traditionally with tags and categories, but that's folksonomic, and it's very imperfect. The promise of the APIs, whether real or not, we'll see, is we can control that to a far more granular level systemically. So if we have an infrastructure of APIs that connect and translate data between systems, well, effectively, we're able to not dictate tools, but dictate how data travels and how much control individuals have over it. That's a very different system. It's more like a subway system, right? Like, there's that tool right now that a lot of people use called If This Then That. Have you heard of it?
Yes, but probably not everyone has.
Yeah, so If This Then That is a translator tool. It allows you to, for example, take a blog post, and like Yahoo Pipes used to, that blog post, you can kind of draw a connection to your Instagram or your Twitter or your Facebook, wherever you wanted it, or somewhere else, and it would actually not only post it on your blog, but it would send it to these various places. And so you had recipes to create links between various applications. Well, that's the promise of the API, and that's what If This Then That is doing. There's no reason why we couldn't have an If This Then That infrastructure at our institutions, which, for example, allow me to do it in Google Docs, if that's where I choose to, but share it securely with the university via Lee. Why not? Right? I mean, that's a point in technology where we are. Like, this is not imaginary. This is actually happening.
I think what's interesting, maybe we can dig deeper into the questions of APIs, because probably not everyone's familiar with the idea. So what is very important, I think, to point out is that it's not the case that you have to change all the systems that are there. Mm-hmm. You don't have to throw away what you have been done before. But the idea is to connect the existing systems. So
exactly.
It's like the tube or the... Is there, I just looked it up. Is the word pneumatic tube an English word? For the German, it's Rohrpost.
Yeah, it's so like a pneumatic tube.
Yes, like, yep. I don't know, 100 years ago. So it's like connecting the various places. So could you give us maybe just a two-minute 101 on APIs?
I could, and I would really recommend talk to Ken Lane or look up his stuff online. KINLANE. Great. API evangelist, genius. He's the person who turned me on to them. You met him at the MIT hackathon a couple of years back.
Yes, 2013.
Yeah.
We just post a link under this video because we had our first discussion there. We have a video from Reclaim Open.
That's right. And that was the beginning of a lot of this. So I'm a big fan of yours. So Ken introduces APIs like this. Like APIs, in this regard, are exactly that. They're connection points. It literally stands for Application Programming Interface. So that's what it means. And APIs are a victim of their acronym. Because APIs, when I say it and I try and explain it, you're like, I still can't get my head around it. So the best way to give an example is through an application. If you use Twitter, right? Twitter is a really interesting example. Twitter built this infrastructure of a very simple 140 characters post, right? Well, what happened is Twitter opened up part of its code so that other people could connect with it and build applications on top of it. So they gave them what is called a developer key, right? You have an idea, you develop something, and it sits on top of Twitter's code base and allows you to build extra features into it. Well, that's the kind of extreme edge if you're a coder of APIs. If I'm an individual and I want to securely share a post I do on my blog through Twitter, I need to get an API key. And I need to basically use that key to unlock my ability to send data from my blog through Twitter. This used to be done seamlessly with RSS. And a lot of people bemoan the passing of RSS, which is really simple syndication, which just allowed, it was an open standard all applications used to have or need, and this would allow you to post one place and seamlessly send it to another. APIs, the good part about it is it does that it makes it technically far more seamless. But the bad part is APIs, because of the way they're structured, is anyone at any time can turn off their API. So Twitter has consistently peeled back layers of their API, or actually not peeled back, closed off layers of their API. So programmers who have built applications on top of it can no longer run them because Twitter doesn't give them access to that code. So the dark side of APIs are they're far more controlled, or can be far more controlled. They're not all open. A lot of IT organizations love that because it gives them more granular control. But one of the issues a lot of people have is it's not an open standard, and not all applications have APIs. It's becoming more and more the reality that you need an application to translate between these two forces. But the interesting thing to me about APIs is RSS has disappeared for the most part from most applications. So API, love it or hate it, is our only option to start thinking about this form of integration. The thing about an API that should tell you something, though, is if an application has an API, all APIs aren't created equal. So the question when you go to an API is, what data does that application give you access to? So if you're thinking about an application programming interface is an interface where you can get into application and get certain data, the next question would be is, what data can I get, right? So say I want to, you know, for example, get into the Twitter API. What will that give me? Will that give me access to X amount of tweets? Will that allow me to take those tweets and republish them somewhere else? Would allow me to kind of mix and match and recontextualize those tweets with another application through a mashup? So all of this stuff is actually specific to that application interface. Arguably, every application a university uses should have an API, meaning that it can interface with another application or even an individual. And that to me becomes the portal for the application to share data, to translate data, and to connect. I don't know if to the audience out there that makes any sense. I have to be honest, APIs are something that for years I've been struggling to wrap my head around. And I think the best way to learn them is actually to start looking around. There's a great tool on the web called the Charles Proxy. Go look for it. It's a small application. You can download it. What that Charles Proxy will show you on your computer, and I learned this from Ken Lane, is all the times over the course of a day, different API calls are made to your computer from various applications to get data from you. So Facebook, for example, will be making X amount of API calls to your personal machine to get data from you that you never knew it was taking. Same thing with Twitter, same thing with YouTube. And what you start to see in a scary manner, this is called the Charles Proxy, get it, is all the ways in which APIs are being used to exchange data. What you don't know is it's happening all the time. I think part of the literacy we need to be teaching faculty, students, and administrators, whoever, is how much data is being exchanged and used through APIs on a regular basis.
API literacy.
Exactly. I think it's crucial. And I think it's all right if you don't fully understand it. I can't claim to be a master of it. But I think this is becoming a really important, because if we take what Ken Lane and Audrey Waters say, that data is the new oil, and that's what's being mined, and that's what people are selling, and it's our data, then it would be very important that people be mindful of how that data is being used, how their data is being used on a regular basis, particularly if this is something the German government is really concerned about, and they should be. So a personal literacy around how data is used through these applications we're using would seem like, you know, API 101, and you could do that for grade school kids, or you could do that for college kids.
Do you have an overview on the state of the art of API and existing like learning management systems and so on? So is it a dream, or are there really the connection, are the dots already there and only have to be connected?
Some of them are. Like for Canvas, which is an LMS system in America, I think it's starting to make inroads in Europe and the UK. They have an API built in. They also have things called LTIs. LTIs, they're similar to APIs. They don't have the same functionality. So they have some limitations versus LTI. But they basically are applications that integrate with. So one of the things that Canvas promised was you could use Canvas, but it would be a whole suite of tools. Like, it wouldn't exclude you from also using Google Docs or also using WordPress or also using, like, it would have a way to allow you to hook into all of these various tools. And that was the logic of the API, right? A connector to all these tools. Some of them have them, some of them don't. For example, Blackboard is still struggling to build an API. D2L has some, and these are all LMS or VLE systems in the US. Canvas does have a pretty robust API. So it's unevenly distributed. What we're finding, at least in the US, is there's never been more pressure on people to build an API and to have an API, because this becomes the logic by which you can share and move your data. So one of the questions you should be asking whenever you go into an application, like, so say you're looking at an LMS or a VLE, the question you got to ask yourself is, if we're leaving the system, how do we get our data out? And 9 times out of 10, that's going to be a reflection upon the API and a reflection upon how open or closed that is. And there's a great service called Too Long Didn't Read, TLDR. It's an expression we have in the States, and it may be here, refer to those service level agreements, right? Those contracts you sign away when you sign up to Facebook and Twitter, like all that legalese you never read. Well, there's a site called Too Long Didn't Read, which shows you exactly what you're giving up when you sign or when you agree to those terms of services. A lot of times you're giving up any privacy. A lot of times you're giving up the actual things you post, any right to reuse them or any right to say you have control over them. It's really telling. And that for me goes hand in hand with API literacy, is privacy literacy. How much of the work we do are we giving away? And how much of our own personal information are we giving away? And giving away willfully. Like, we're not, like, it's not like someone has a gun to our head. Like, we're just doing it because we want the affordances of these community sites.
Huh. We always sign, like, we agree. So it's like thinking about an exit strategy before you enter.
Yeah, exactly. And Too Long Didn't Read is great.
I think there are browser plugins for Too Long Didn't Read, so that it shows up in your browser, says there's an information on TLDR on this page here.
That's awesome. I'd like to see that.
I look it up and see it on the show notes. Okay. So probably the open source tools like Moodle are more into APIs than other services, huh?
Yeah, you would hope. But like even WordPress, which is open source, been around for a decade now, they're still waiting to roll out their API.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Luckily, with WordPress, there's a plugin that's called the JSON API plugin that really builds on top of it a robust API infrastructure, but it's still not core. But if you think about what WordPress is doing, and I have to say I'm getting here into kind of imaginative territory, so forgive me. WordPress right now is rewriting WordPress.com, not in PHP. They're rewriting it all in JavaScript. Why would they do that, right? Well, WordPress.com and WordPress in general is coming to the mind of, look, you're going to want to have your own space. You're going to want to have your own blog. You're just going to want to connect back to WordPress for like your Jetpack plugin, your subscribe to comments, your Google Analytics or your analytics tools with them.
Image hosting now, I guess.
Yeah. Yes. So basically, they're imagining the fact that WordPress.com can still help you syndicate and post from WordPress.com, but it goes to your own space. In fact, they're doing a kind of sophisticated API syndication framework that's called Calypso. And this is something that we could imagine and build as part of infrastructure. Like, don't try and build the WordPress multi-site that holds 80 million sites. In fact, let everyone manage their own site, but build the interface that connects all those different pieces. So in many ways, they're disaggregating their service and they're thinking more long-term about giving people their own space. You can still get a WordPress.com site, but if you have your own site, you can still connect with all the resources of WordPress.com. I think for WordPress, that took a major overhaul of their code base in terms of WordPress.com. It's something they're calling Calypso, and you can see it. So if you have a WordPress blog and you're writing, there'll be a little thing is, write this in WordPress.com, right? It will actually say, go to WordPress.com do it all there, but still keep your site. And that abstraction of the processes and the posting from the application is more and more what we'll see as APIs and this infrastructure changes, or at least that's what I think.
Can there be like another dark side of the APIs, like a one-way API? So you can imagine that WordPress.com could go the other way. So yes, you can do everything connected with WordPress.com.
Yeah.
But it's a one-way street. Like maybe Facebook does. Facebook is offering a lot of services connected to their like central hub
That's
station
right.
or not. But you can't do it the other way around.
That happens all the time, absolutely. And Ken Lane has probably the most thorough kind of grading system or evaluation of APIs and which ones are the most nefarious and which ones are the most open. And yeah, you're right. It's a spectrum. Some, they lock down everything and they just take. Others, they take and give freely at the same amount. And that's kind of that literacy around what APIs reflect, you know, that kind of ethos of open and sharing and moving your data seamlessly should tell you a lot about an application and what they want from you and what your relationship to them is. And that's something to keep in mind. I really like that, actually, that him and Audrey have been doing that hard work for years now.
Okay. You have a service called Domain of One's Own.
I do.
And what are you doing, basically, when you get up in the morning? what is it about, and who are you working with? What is the idea of Reclaim Hosting?
Well, Domain of One's Own is really, I think, the brainchild of many of us at Mary Washington back when we were doing this hosting thing, was the idea of giving faculty and students the same thing we had, their own domain and web hosting, so they can install their own WordPress rather than depending on us. It wasn't until Tim Owens, who's my co-founder and partner in Reclaim, who it really broke open, because he came and he was kind of just one of those people who's a really quick study. He's really sharp. And he said, look, I think we can build this infrastructure in-house for really cheap. And so he went about installing, you know, cPanel on a server, rolling it up, integrating the domain registry, and effectively integrating web hosting as part of a service for our university and making it so simple that it was three steps to get a WordPress up and running. And so Tim had both the technical ingenuity and genius as well as the design chops to make this something that was actually possible, right? Like, not only like, oh, it's this big technical infrastructure you got to manage. No, it's single sign-on, it's integrated, and it's easy. And I think once we did that and we proved that at Mary Washington, we've had, you know, scores of schools from all over the U.S. who were like, look, we want that. We want to provide our faculty and students this experience. We want to give certain faculty and students the ability to install and manage their own applications on their own domains. So we got interest. That interest was so and continues to be so heavy, I guess. I don't know how you would say it. The interest so great that we went on our own. We left Mary Washington. I left in September. Tim left the previous February. And we went full-time for Reclaim. And so what we're doing on a daily basis, and why I can live in Italy, is we're supporting institutions and individuals by giving them, you know, hosting. We do it institutionally. We do it individually. We do shared hosting. We do dedicated hosting. But the thing that's cool is it becomes a huge playground for Tim and I to imagine what this changing virtualization infrastructure means for universities. For example, we're working with Brigham Young University to integrate the university API and the personal API. So the personal API, working with several institutions, is a project we're part of. We're not driving it. The institutions are, because they need to. But we're providing the technical infrastructure and the thinking around what's possible and how an institution might do this creatively and thoughtfully so that the learning ecosystems of the future are more about giving students power over their data and connecting them with the various infrastructures and tools they want to use rather than what they're dictated to use.
When you were leaving school, could you imagine being a provider for web services then?
No. And people say you're crazy when we say, because, you know, there's a certain amount of pressure. Like, you want to keep people's sites up. And what we've done, and I think why, like, look, we're not doing anything radical. Hosting's been around for over a decade. You know, we don't pretend that we're some new thing. Oh, my God, hosting, where did you come from? No. What we do is we provide targeted support for educational institutions and for educators and for students. So when you come to Reclaim, what you get is you get people who know about education and who are thoughtful and who are going to give you targeted support. And I think the only reason we're doing as well as we are is because our support is great. Because we recognize some people are not getting that support in their institutions. And institutions have been our best friends in terms of supporting us because they don't want to. Excuse me. They really don't want to, and I don't mean this as a knock, but they don't want to have to worry about the infrastructure.
So when it comes back to EduPunk, probably there is a connection because it's always been the idea of Punk to just create your own system and your own infrastructure. If you're not, if you don't like the infrastructure given. So that reminds me of a slide you shown today. It was by, what's the name of the black flag?
Greg Ginn.
Yes. Do you know the words?
Yeah, he basically said, if you're not happy with the system the man's providing, build your own.
So that's what you're providing as a service to punks out there like universities.
Exactly.
So, but you don't have to tell them because probably they won't do it if you tell them like this. You just have to tell them that you're a provider.
I learned quickly that once you call it punk, everybody looks at you askance. Once you call it DS-106, they don't know what it means. So they're like, what's that? But if once you say EduPunk, forget it. It's over. That's okay. Why it's called not an EduPunk of one's own. It's called the domains of one's own.
Just great. Great. We have 1 hour now, nearly. So is there anything you would think of that Germany should know about these discussions?
I mean, I think one of my struggles, and this is a struggle that's ongoing for me, is, and this is a good one, and I think I'll end here, is my system and the way I imagine it is very much dominated by the individual. The idea that the individual should have their own space, the individual should control their space, they should be their own archivist, this should be something that they imagine and build as part of who they are, their online digital persona, their identity. Where the individual and the community meet in this is an infrastructural, technical, and a cultural, and a personal problem. Not, and I don't mean problem, maybe that's the wrong word, challenge. How do we make sure we honor the importance of the individual and their control over their stuff, but still enable seamless, fluid communities? And I think syndication and APIs have the power to do that. I think once they're not open and they present some of the problems you said of like unilateral control, we reproduce a lot of the same systems we've already had. So I'm very much interested in how we respect and balance individual and communities in an infrastructure like I'm talking about with DS-106. And we've had some success with it. But the alternative is folks like Mike Caulfield who are in the U.S. talking about we focus way too much on the individual and we need to do more stuff like we do in Wikipedia where it's communal, where we all contribute to a common good. And it's not so much about the individual in a stream of reverse chronology. It's about an ongoing resource we build as a culture. And it's a compelling case. I mean, I believe that people are self-interested and that they're going to want to focus on them. And that might be the American in me. That might also be part of the cultural, historical moment we live in. I don't necessarily think it's a good thing entirely. So I struggle with that. I don't have a clean answer to that. And I think that's a tension that's real and needs to be balanced. And the other question is questions of equity, social justice. You know, are we building infrastructure for our institutions and for the various constituents that we serve that hopefully give everyone somewhat of an equal footing and empowerment to express themselves and to get access? And, you know, it's been said at this conference before, and you don't need me to repeat it, but, you know, I can get lost in the tech and the ideas and so much, but some of those issues are not technical. A lot of them are cultural and social and have everything to do with inequities that play out in culture, you know. So I don't pretend that technology is necessarily a solution to that. You know what I mean? I won't sit here and pretend that.
This is great for closing. So it has been very, very, very interesting talking to you. And thanks again. And I hope we will meet, like, what was it now? Like 2.5 years from the last video we did to this podcast. So probably in 2018, we will have our next episode.
I'll put it in my calendar.
And I would like to come to Italy to do this.
I'm right down the street from you. It's a 4-hour train ride to Munich.
Yes, but Munich is a 6-hour train ride to Hamburg.
Why is Germany so big?
It is not, but...
It is big. I heard it was the biggest European nation, the most populated.
The most populated is, yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So, but maybe I can invite you to a German OER conference before 2018. Would be great.
Yeah, that would be. You just let me know.
I learned today that it was today your first talk in the UK. How first is this possible?
Yeah, I've never. This is. I love it. I mean, it's my first time. I was nervous. I was definitely nervous. Yeah. I don't know how the Europeans are going to take to this crap I'm selling. I'm a used car salesman. Right? I don't know what they're going to do with me. You know, they might see through me.
Okay, so we have to add that everyone was really excited about it. And I just cited the tweet from Mao, and I don't know her name. It was like, it feels like a special moment listening to you talking at OER 16. So it was also a special moment talking to you on this podcast. Thanks again. All the best for your work.
Hey, thank you. I really appreciate you having me.
Das war Zugehört, der Podcast rund um Open Educational Resources. Weitere Informationen zum Podcast finden Sie unter www.open-educational-resources.de/podcast.